Sir, or Ta Tipene O'Regan, was named New Zealander of the Year last night. Take a look.
The New Zealander of the Year. It is my honour to also offer you our trophy as the New Zealander of the Year, e papa.
It's fair to say that Ta Tipene was somewhat shell-shocked by that announcement, and he was recognised for his work and life's dedication to building an inclusive and bicultural nation. Best known for his roles as chairman of the Ngāi Tahu Māori Trust Board, where he led the iwi settlement claim and fisheries settlements in the late 80s and early 90s. These achievements, only a few of his accomplishments. Ta Tipene O'Regan's an educator, a well-known public figure, and he sat down with me for a chat to look back on all he has achieved. Ane tō tātou pau whakarai o Aotearoa, our New Zealander of the Year, Ta Tipene O'Regan.
Ta Tipene, I te tuatahi, nei rā te mihi aroha ki a koe te rangatira, nōku te whiwhi ki te kōrero atu ki a koe i tēnei rā. I feel of huge privilege to be sitting here, being able to have this interview, this kōrero with you today. So thank you. And I guess first of all, congratulations.
Kia koe hoki. Kia koe hoki. Ka tika tō manaaki tō mihi. E mihi a tāhua. Ka te whakapūpūni o hau, ko te kiti ki a koe i roto o tēne ata. Tēnā koe, Jenny, mai.
Congratulations. How does it feel to be named Kiwi Bank New Zealander of the Year?
Well, I've had various cynical thoughts about it. You needed a token mail there somewhere. You needed a token geriatric mail was quite helpful. That's the cynical side of it. But I like to think it was because people have recognised the importance of the things I've done over my time and the kind of way I've been able to shape events that have benefited the kind of people we may yet become.
You had no idea that you had won the Kiwi Bank New Zealander of the Year, right?
No.
So
I thought I've had all my money on Hine Wehi.
Why?
Because she's amazing.
Not all of us wake up every morning saying, what can I do better for, how can I make our country better? How can I make New Zealand's constitution better? We don't get up like that. But throughout your whole life, that seems to be you.
It's not so much the getting up, it's what time you go to sleep. And my good friend, Doug Kidd, the Honourable Doug Kidd, he once said to me, the great trick of working around this place is never going to sleep. The energy and the passion comes from a belief which I understand better from this end of my life than I did at the beginning. I think it was 1959 I first published my first bit of writing on race relations in New Zealand and where I thought the Treaty of Waitangi should be. I find that I'm fueled by the same sense now today that I had then. By accident, exhumed a copy of this little piece, and I was astonished to find how little I'd shifted over that time.
Where do you think we are at as a country when it comes to te tiriti? So where are we now?
Well, I think we've come at an enormous distance, and I think the dog-whistling white supremacists are now much fewer than we had, but there is a knot in our country's physiology. It's much more intense, and I think that's been happening in a number of ways. that I think we've come a great distance in our mutual understanding. Positions that Māori take are not sufficiently thought through. They fail to understand the very wide breadth of support for a culturally vibrant and culturally interactive society that we have the capacity to become. I think they still think the treaty is for the benefit of Māori, whereas it's as much for the benefit of the new person arriving in this country as a refugee or a migrant. We've come a great distance. It's hard to believe that Māori Language Week or Waitangi Weekend, that sort of thing, you'll get the banner headlines on newspapers in Te Reo Māori, that you'll get a much wider toleration and understanding. It says that we as a country are becoming much more accommodating of each other, and I think we're doing that pretty well. And it's not something that's brand new. The people from the north and the south of New Zealand, 20 years before the treaty, were engaging with each other, trading with each other, and marrying each other. And that's a sort of core that I've been privileged to spring from. Both my poa and my taua, my ngaitahu, grandfather and grandmother, were of mixed descent. So those networks of whakapapa going back through our history, there's many, many families like that. And that's a very strong interlocking factor. We should be able to rejoice in both of them. There are people who are here by right of indigeneity, and there are people who are here by right of the treaty. And so the treaty is important to us all as a foundational thing. It's not just some sort of thing that works only for Māori. And of course, we've got to remember that the treaty has been evolving, and we're evolving with it. And I think one of the challenges for our people, at least from my own iwi, is to incorporate into their forward vision how they want Aotearoa New Zealand to be.
Kia ora anō. Before the break, 2022 New Zealander of the Year, Tā Tipene O'Regan, shared with us his views on how far we have come as a nation. Well, now he talks about what he sees for our future.
As long as we continue to evolve and to ensure that we shape our own view of New Zealand as we want it to be, and we're culturally accommodating of each other, and we understand the nature of the nation's indigenous heritage and its places, it's a way of paying respect to each other. As a people, the fundamental thing we need to do is to know where we're from, understand the nature of our past, because that gives you the capacity to envisage a future which is founded, which is rooted, which has got long, long roots into the place you come from.
So then, I'm thinking about history, our history, being taught in schools. Where do you sit with that?
Oh, I'm very hugely positive about it, but in terms of what's happening in the schools, I'm more concerned that we don't replace one simple, poor narrative with another inadequate narrative. And juxtaposing Māori and Pākehā without understanding the nature of the interconnection and the constitutional questions that are in it, and without dealing with that huge wellspring of Pākehā goodwill towards Māori over the years and their supportive character. We had a Governor-General who resigned over Parihaka. We had a Chief Justice who resigned over Waitara in the 1860s. we had all these people, they don't get mentioned. We spend all our time getting upset about poor old Prendergast.
That'll be the challenge though, right? Is what we include in the history in our schools.
Indeed, indeed. But we've got to make sure we're balanced. There was some of the most brutal slaughter of Māori post-Musket was conducted by Māori against Māori. The Army or Whenua that left Taitokoro, 1825. That Army or Whenua is said to have reduced the Māori population by 25%. And it was just a big butchering meat hunt. It was appalling. And it had, the worst part of it was, there was no take in it. There was no cause of war. It was a desire to just go out and become the dominant kingpin. Well, that whole thing is also within the history of Māori into iwi. We've got to accommodate that as well as the others. That's the human story.
Can we talk about the kremi? Can we talk about the claim, which was 150 years in the making?
Seven generations.
You finally settled that in 1998. And I imagine that there were times during that was quite lonely.
I never felt amongst my colleagues at that time there was any urge or desire to give it up. There was two or three items still on the table. Jim Bolger was sitting out with a cell phone. That was in the days when the cell phones came in their own suitcase. They looked around the room and they're all listening in. I played my last card and there was a long silence. But the room, my colleagues were looking at the ceiling, looking at the floor, looking everywhere but at me. And I felt very lonely. And I said, Prime Minister, you have a settlement. And Jim thanked me and hung up. And I walked outside and I lit my pipe. And I took about two puffs and collapsed in tears. When I did that, I started to think, have I done the right thing? Is this the right call? And I started to have all my self-doubts afterwards. But as one of my advisors at the time, a lawyer, said, you've done everything you could do, there's nothing left in the cupboard. Mm-hmm. And I think I understood that. Mm-hmm. Because the last thing we wanted to do was to bankrupt the very country in which we wanted to become a more functional part.
Where's Ngāi Tahu now, from then until now?
Oh, we've still got some pretty significant challenges. We have a very wide geography. There's sometimes not the level of unity within us. We've got to redesign a more integrative thing, but we're down the track far enough to see what mistakes we've made and what we can do better. But we've got a lot of vastly more competent younger people capable of making a contribution. I can't tell what's going to happen, but I'm confident that there'll be people to maintain us.
What are you most proud of?
I think the thing I'm most proud of is that she's trusted me for nearly 60 years. Even though I've been a bugger to live with.
It's your beautiful wife, Sandra.
Indeed.
On that note, thank you for your time. Congratulations.
Tēnā te mihi atu ki a koe.
Tēnā te mihi atu ki a koe, te rangatira. Thank you for your inspiration, tireless dedication to not only Ngāi Tahu, but towards wanting us to be better and wanting better for our country. Winning New Zealander of the Year is a tribute to your impact, not only on this generation, but the many more to come.